What's the creepiest thing you've seen other families do? I used to live a few houses down from a home that had no windows. Like, it looked like the house had been built that way since the siding was pretty much seamless. Like, it didn't look like they had removed the windows and boarded up or anything like that. And the family that lived there, the random times that I did see them, which was super rare, they would come out totally covered in clothes, like long shirts and pants and gloves and everything, and always with hats of varying sizes. I ended up finding out that they had a skin disorder where they were basically allergic to light or something like that, so it went from creepy to pretty interesting when I found that out, lol. But before that, I avoided that place like it was cursed. My family has this. Both my brother and my aunt. My brother has gotten better, but when we were kids, there's photos of us in Disney in the summer with my brother in a hoodie, jean, hat, and gloves. His sensitivity has gotten better and is no longer that severe, still has the sensitivity and will be in a lot of pain with sunburns. My aunt still has it pretty bad. When we go to the lake house during the summer, when we're all on the dock partying in the sun, she sits inside. The only days she hangs out on the beach are when it's overcast and misty. I have this sensitivity too, but very mildly, and it only bothers my face. But let me tell you, it hurts. I know what it's like to have a regular sunburn, but nothing compares to it. It feels like you're literally burning from the inside out and nothing helps. Aloe doesn't do anything. In fact, for me, on my face, it amplifies the burn. The only thing you can really do is sit in an air-conditioned room with cold rags, which is exactly what my brother and aunt do when they feel like their entire body is burning from inside out like that. It sucks and it's real. No one ever believes me. Allergic to the sun, like, okay. Had a friend named Kent in fourth grade. His family was messed up. His mom was in prison for trying to kill him and his little sisters by locking them in their house and setting it on fire. Kent saved his sisters' lives but was burnt on 90% of his body. He had masks, special sleeves for his legs and arms. It was horrible for him. Other kids were weirded out by him, but I thought it was so unfair how kids treated him because they didn't understand. Hell, my own stepmother had beat the shit out of me 100 times by that age. But what happened the one night I stayed over at Kent's house will forever be etched in my mind. It was a normal weekend night. We had a Super Nintendo, a large pizza, bogs, and a whole basement to ourselves. We eat, drink, play till we pass out. In the middle of the night, his little sister comes running down the basement steps crying hysterically and peed herself and is shaking, having a full-blown panic attack. Once I wake up and see Kent is not waking up, I realize upstairs sounds like a bowling alley or a bar fight. I can't get Rose to calm down and Kent won't wake up, so I go searching for an adult. Up the basement steps is the dining room, and as I open the door, I see Kent's dad and his new wife covered in blood, cocaine, literally trying to kill each other. Neither really had clothes on, neither noticed me, and they were out to kill each other. What did I do? Turned around and went back downstairs and sat with his sister until she fell asleep. Woke up the next day and they acted like nothing happened. The house was cleaned up. Both of them looked, well, better than the night before. Served the kids donuts like it was any normal Sunday morning. I told my dad every detail of the story when I got home, and he looked sick when I was done. He went and told the story to several people, who ended up finding out Kent's dad was a fairly big-time drug dealer and woman beater. Kent moved away shortly after that, and I've never heard a thing about him since. I still wonder to this day if him and his sisters are okay. And that's the story of the weirdest shit I ever saw another family do. Got plenty more stories, but that one bothers me most. That was just like my aunt whenever she babysat us. She'd babysit my sisters and I about one weekend a month. If you see the pictures of us, we looked like dolls. She'd spend hours dressing us up in uncomfortable, frilly, ridiculously girly clothes, doing our makeup, our hair. Then we'd just sit around while she took pictures, or invite a friend over and make us serve them tea. It was weird. She had odd bathroom rules too. I was old enough where it wasn't a big deal, but she would make my little sisters wear diapers as part of their outfits. I used to work evenings and get home around 10:30-11 p.m. I would drive by that home where are the little kids were sitting in a circle listening to a man who seemed to be reading them the Bible. They were all very well dressed, jacket, white shirt, so it was really eerie. I don't have kids, but I know they should have been sleeping hours ago. Years later, the sob got arrested for child abuse. My friend in college, we'll call him Bob, never talked much about his family. I could tell he had some money, but as a lower class goof, I wasn't really sure how much. All I knew was Bob had two flat screen TVs and had this sort of carefree attitude about him, like, he never worried too much about anything. One day he asked me to ride with him to pick his family up from the airport. I was worried because the flight was due in 15 minutes and the airport is 45 minutes away. But we didn't drive to the big airport. We drove to the little municipal strip right outside town, where Bob's family's private Gulfstream was taxiing toward us. The family crest emblazoned on the side. Bob's family owned and managed a $56 billion hedge fund. I wondered why Bob drove his F-150 like a sports car, and finally got my answer. He had learned to drive at 16, in a Ferrari. I eventually visited one of their homes and it was like a museum. Another home was previously owned by a legendary superstar rock star. Another home was on a Bahamian island. Next to the island was their 185 meters yacht. The creepiest thing about this family was that to this day they were the kindest, nicest, sweetest people I've ever met. The whole family was polite and respectful to one another. The kids really loved their parents, and the parents really cherished their own children. To someone like me, a low-class boob with schizophrenic, drug-addled parents who were always poor and gambling, it was too much. I work with special needs kids, and it's odd when that quiet stranger pays for something big. I'm talking taking 50 families to a MLB game plus catered gourmet meal before, or a campground for disabled kids which needs its pathways paved for kids in wheelchairs, gets a call from a contractor asking how much is needed, and don't worry about it, someone has it covered. And they don't even ask for a tax receipt. The leader didn't know who they were, but suspected it was the kind family who just showed up to work for a week but wouldn't talk about their personal life, only to find out later they own a major amusement park chain. A couple of times when we had our charity auction, some guy would walk up and hand me a $10,000 check. Those people make it point to not tell who they are so as not to get hit up by others. Well, actually the couple who did the baseball thing were right there in the VIP lunch tent doing things like helping people carry plates of food, cleaning up tables, helping busy parents with their kids and such. In the Christian religion that I was raised in, we are taught that the Bible says that when it comes to charity, the left hand should never know what the right hand has done. You absolutely never let anyone know about your charitable giving. If you are doing it for recognition, you receive no blessing. And if you're giving just to receive blessings, that doesn't work either. You give because it's the right thing to do. I had a woman come through my line yesterday, who spent like almost $800 on groceries. It was the largest order I had ever done. And while I rung it all up, she was so nice. My bagger and I walked the groceries out to her brand new electric Porsche or whatever, and she stayed in the pouring rain with us while we helped pack her car up. The inside of her car must have gotten so wet, yet she didn't mind. At the end, all I could think was how I couldn't believe she was that wealthy because of how nice she was. It's a wild experience. I run a small private cocktail bar that only opens for reservations. We had a particularly wealthy guy in one night. I only knew who he was because a friend worked for him, and he had recently sold his company for $175 million. I mentioned this to a guy I bartend with after they left. He was surprised the guy was so down to earth. I mentioned that most wealthy people I knew were the same way. He had probably the best, most real comment I have ever heard on the subject. I guess I just thought all rich people were assholes, since all the people I knew growing up that wanted to be rich are assholes. When I moved halfway across the country with my parents at age 17, I hated my new school. The first time I did anything with other kids was a Saturday afternoon went shopping and to lunch with a couple girls in my psychology class. They were just the nicest people I've ever met. We had to go to one of their houses to pick up something. It was the hugest house I've ever seen. Had an indoor pool. I had no idea this chick had money since she was driving a rental car as her own was in the shop. Turns out these two girls were part of the richest families in town. But they were just so kind to me, taking out a new girl who had no friends. I'll never forget that kindness. Lived down the street from a Christian family who would literally board up their windows and drive out of town every Halloween. I mean actual boards on the windows, nailed in, van piled with all the kids' stuff, gone for days. I guess the dad thought the trick-or-treaters were actual demons or something. The little boy asked us for some candy one year, and actually got in trouble for it. When I was in high school, I went with an ex-girlfriend to one of her friend's houses for dinner. It was the first time either of us had been there. The kitchen floor was covered in sand, which I thought was weird, but for some reason ignored. Before dinner was ready, the mom was just sitting at the dining room table talking to us when her like 6-year-old son came running in from outside where he was playing in a swing set and said, "Mom, I want some titty." The mother just whipped her boob out right in front of us and kept talking while this first grader just stands next to her and feeds on it. Couldn't even wait for the meal that was almost ready. I don't remember how I figured it out, but apparently they let their chickens in the house and the sand on the floor is like a litter box for them, so it's easy to pick up their mess. Anyway, the whole thing creeped me out and we ended up leaving before dinner and just went to Jack in the Box instead. When I moved into my first house, there was this rundown house in front of me. I didn't think much of it. There was a family who lived there and they seemed normal. Until one day when I came home from work, I saw a dead bird on my doorstep. But not just any dead bird, it looked like it had been stepped on multiple times. I cleaned up what was left of the bird until the neighbor boy from the house across talked to me later that night. He told me on how his mother tells him to practice kindness towards others, which meant acting like a damn cat. Apparently his mom approved of his behavior. Kid scared me and gave dead birds to almost everyone. Thank God they moved away. When I was growing up, I had a friend whose mom was a sex worker. No shame, so what you gotta do. But the problem was she had Johns while the kids were there. The weirdest part was when the men were leaving, they would ask the men for money, which I thought was so weird. And the regulars would bring toys for the kids and stuff. And one night me and my friend were like 10 and one of the men kept calling and then showed up and was banging on the door and windows. And the kids acted like it was nothing. I grew up in a religious organization that was questionably cult-like at times. It attracted all kinds of people who would all then live on what we called base. When I was around 12, I remember this one family that would dedicate at least 45 minutes on Sundays jumping to practice for the rapture. I guess it was to get a head start or something. I stayed pretty far away from them cause they were weird overall. I left the organization as soon as I turned 18, but until then was deemed a problem child. Yeah, that's gross. Story time on that. I have a very smart and curious cat that disappeared for a month and came back looking like a skeleton with fur. The first week back she ate. One night shortly after she came back, during dinner she came up to me. She dug her claw into my chin and pulled open my mouth. She stuck her nose into my mouth and attempted to steal what I chewing. It was funny but also gross. Not sure why she did this, because she had food in her dish. Down the block from me when I was around 10 was a family with two kids, a daughter my age and a brother a few years older. Once during a slumber party, they admitted they practiced kissing and more on each other, so they'd be good at it later, when they started dating. It was never clear just how far they went with each other. The parents were also a bit weird, insisted serving us all giant heaping spoonfuls of vitamin powder, or else we weren't allowed to eat dinner, and putting milk on cereal would earn a grounding. Only apple juice was allowed, even though milk was otherwise consumed in normal ways in their house. Being grounded sometimes meant being locked in a dark room with the light bulbs removed. When I was 15, my first real girlfriend wanted to tell me a funny story. She said her stepfather was taking a bath, and called her in and told her to wash his hair, so she grabbed the shampoo and started scrubbing. After a few minutes she says, "Why isn't this shampoo foaming?" Then she said she realized she was using baby oil, not shampoo, and started laughing about the story. I was just standing there with a "what the fuck" look on my face, and she's laughing, realizes I'm not, and says, "What?" I said, "Your stepfather makes you wash his hair ... in the bathtub." And she got extremely defensive about it, said it was no big deal, she did it all the time, it's not weird. So I asked why he didn't ask her mother, his wife, to do it. She said she won't do it. She got upset that I thought it was weird, said I was being gross, and being only 15 I let it go. Now, many years later, adult me believes 100% he was molesting her. Stayed with my elementary school best friend and her family a lot. They are all around regular folks. One night we're up late talking etc. and she asks if I want to see something but I can't tell anyone she showed me. Sure. We get up and tiptoe through the dark house to the den. She grabs a 6x8x2 porcelain jewelry box off the side table and opens it, full to the brim with old boogers. Her whole family of four would pick their noses and then mush the fresh boogers into the booger box to form a booger collection. All different shades and varying degrees of crusty, just chillin' inconspicuously on the side table. I was unable to look at any of them in the same way afterwards. It's been 20 plus years, but I think about that more often than I'd care to admit, lol. I've thought about this so much, I've commented this little story before under another question. I just want the world to suffer with me, I suppose. Haven't thought of this in years and am shuddering now thinking about it. Guy in high school I played football with was close with his mother to a creepy degree. He had a party at his house one night and his mother was out trying to be the cool mom having drinks with people. At one point he ended up doing a body shot of tequila off his mother. Not sure what happened to that guy. I'm sure he's now living in a house with a headless doll collection and a few guests in the basement. I think this is more of a cultural thing than a creepy thing, but it freaked me out when I was 8. My bro and I used to play with one of the neighbor's kids and one day he invited us over and his mom was happy to host her home for her son's friends. She bought out jerky and my bro and I ate them and were thinking that this was a bit of a weird meat. Definitely something fishy about it. We learned it was turtle meat. I've been a vegetarian, unrelated reason, since I was 11, 28 now. And I don't remember what meat really tastes like except turtle meat. I remember what turtle jerky tastes like. In the early 2000s, a 10-year-old ran to see his dad get off the train after dad was done working. Their family always met my fam there on the affluent suburban Chicago platform. Us young moms with four toddlers, young children each, and the dads worked together to welcome the fathers home during the nice months of weather. Their oldest skinned his knee when he tripped and was crying. Aw, poor little guy. Then the weirdest thing happened. Okay, so maybe not creepy, but wait for it. Their family formed a tight circle on the train platform, linking arms. This was done so the 10-year-old boy could nurse from his mother to calm or placate his skinned knee. Not sure what to call the reason for our rapid departure. Respect? Not really. Privacy? Yes, because we were weirded the fuck out. Bingo. Fine. Over. Done with. Whatever. Not my family. None of my business. Couple years later, that woman told me she was pregnant with their sixth child. Oh joy. And she was talking about planting another placenta tree and didn't know where to put it in their backyard with the five other placenta trees. What is a placenta tree? Well, since you asked, it's some ritual after a home birth, that the afterbirth goes into a pre-dug pit. Later on, you plant a tree seedling over it and the tree uses the nutrients of the placenta to grow. Okay, again, fine, to each their own. A year after the birth of the child, that family was moving. The mom and I were talking about logistics of buying, selling in that housing market while we waited with the kids for our husbands at the train platform. And that's when she said it. Oh, we rent our house, so this will be easy for us to move. What? They planted 6 trees in their yard that have human DNA underneath them. All I can think about now in the year 2021 is that some poor soul who rents that house, or owns that plot of land, will now be in the crosshairs of some forensic TV show how the guy who lived there isn't a serial killer from 2003.